Srimati N. Kritika Lakshmi, currently working as Associate Professor in Satyabhama University, Chennai. She has done her Bachelor of Architecture from Periyar Maniammai College of Technology for Women, Bharathidasan University, Trichy, and Postgraduate Diploma in Business Administration from ICFAI University, Hyderabad. She has also done Master of Architecture in Building Management from Satyabhama University, Chennai. She has been involving in developing and delivering lectures for undergraduates and postgraduate students using innovative teaching practices. She has attended several conferences and have made presentations in specialized subject area in architecture.
Welcome to UGC lecture series for Bachelor of Architecture program. This lecture will be on the subject Building Services Part 2. This will be dealing with electrical and electronic systems and lighting design. Now, this particular lecture, we will be looking into electrical and electronic systems about electrical wiring systems. The contents that we will be covering here is laws of electrical circuits, basics of electricity, that is single and three phase supply, earthing for safety, types of earthing and ISI specifications for earthing, then electrical wiring system. To start with, we have to understand some basic electrical theory. Like we know electricity is everywhere, we see lights are on our way, it cooks our food. So, where is it coming from? So, what is electricity basically? It is a movement of charge. So, the charge is moving, the positive charge will be moving to the negative charge, or the negative charge will be moving to the positive charge. So, this flow of electrical charge when it takes place is what we call as electric current. Now, when we say electric current, you have two types of current, direct current and alternating current. So, direct current is the one that flows with a constant voltage polarity, if you see this picture here. So, there is a constant flow and there is a one polar, it goes in one polar direction. And alternating current will be changing periodically, that is why you see the curve here. So, sometimes this will be off on top or off and down. So, also its polarity will be changing. So, these are the major difference between a current, direct current and alternating current. So, when you see a short history, if you see, we know about Thomas Edison. So, Thomas Edison and Alessandro Volta, they were the pioneers in DC current. So, they wrote much of electrical history as we know, but when we start, they started using DC, the transmission was not efficient enough to transmit from one place to another as a DC current, DC direct current. So, there is another person, Nikola Tesla, who came into picture. He invented the alternating current electrical systems. So, when you have an alternating current, it is possible to produce high voltages. That means, you can change the current, like you can have whenever you want, you can increase the voltage or reduce the voltage depending on the usage. So, that is why in most portable devices we use DC current, and when you see a power plants or large power systems, they will produce alternating current. When we talk about electricity, you need an electrical circuit to move these electrical, that is movement of charge, right. So, this flow of electrical charge, for that you have to make, you need a pathway, that pathway is made of wires. So, through these wires only we create a electrical circuit. So, if it is, you have a electrons, if it is goes into a light bulb, so what happens is it gives the power and it makes it to work. Like in a bulb, it will increase the heat inside the filament and the filament will glow, that is what we get as light. So, when you talk about electrical circuits, we have two major laws, and one is Ohm's law and other is the Kirchhoff's law. Without these two laws, there is no circuit calculation and anything. So, when you take Ohm's law, there is basically V is equal to IR, and Kirchhoff's law, you have two things, which is voltage law and current law. Voltage law deals with the conservation of energy, and current law deals with the conservation of charge. So, when you take Ohm's law, V is equal to IR, where V is the voltage. So, voltage is the difference between the charges of any two points, and I is the current, the rate or speed in which the charge is flowing, and resistance is how the flow of charge is being resisted by the materials. So, voltage when you take, it is the product of current and resistance. So, the strength of a direct current as per this law is directly proportional to the potential difference. So, when there is a difference in the current, it is directly proportional, but when you take the resistance, it is inversely proportional. So, this is a measurement that we use to work the charge between unit of what unit of charge is passing between two points. Then you have Kirchhoff's voltage law. This says that any closed loop, so the circuit will be always in a loop. So, if it is a closed loop, the sum of the voltage drops is equal to the sum of the voltage rise. So, when you talk about circuits and charges flowing, there is going to be some loss and some gain. So, as per this voltage law, they say whatever voltage drops will be gained in some other place. Then you have the current law. This is the sum of the current flowing into any point is equal to the sum of the current flowing out. So, whatever current is going into one point, it is going to come out. So, there will be no loss, that is what the current law says. Now, other things we have to know about the basic of electricity is single phase electricity and three phase electricity. We say we have single phase power and three phase power at our homes. So, what is a single phase power does? It actually provides alternating current in which the voltage all travel in the same pattern. If you see, there will be only one single curve that is going on. So, this is very common when the load is very less, that is like only for lighting and heating, if you are going to use the current, then a single phase electricity will do. And a few motors up to 5 HP, you can use a single phase electricity. When it comes to three phase electricity, you can see that there is a three different types of waves you can see here. This is because when the power is being generated, they undergo a special method. Like what happens is there is conductors which are producing the power, generating the power. Each conductor will it reach its top volt or top energy, but all the three conductors will not do it at the same time. Each will go in a order manner, in a phase manner. So, when one is at the tip, when one is at the bottom, the other two will already have gone through. It will be like going in a cycle. So, what happens is at any point of time, you will be having a high voltage will be passing through. So, what happens is this method will have the energy also coming in three lines. So, equal voltage will be there and equal frequency will be there. So, this will produce higher voltage. So, you can power up higher motors or equipments. So, that is why we use a three phase electricity. Particularly, if you have ACs at home, you definitely require three phase electricity. So, that is the reason, because three phase electricity can support higher voltages. Then coming to earthing, the next important basic of electricity is earthing. Earthing is, it is connecting any non-current carrying conductor part. So, in an equipment, there is always any some part will not be conducting current, but that is present in the, it is also a conductor of electricity, it is present in the equipment. So, what happens is that is a loose connection. So, that has to be grounded, that is what we call earthing. So, with the general mass of earth, so that there is an immediate discharge. So, whatever is current is passing through that non-current carrying part of the system, that will, that electricity in that system will be discharged. So, if that is not discharged, what happens is whenever we touch it or when we use that appliance or equipment, that current will pass on to us. That is what we call, we get electric shock when we touch certain appliances or equipments. That is because that non-current conducting, carrying conducting part is not properly earthed. So, for the safety of human beings, so when this electrical shock passes through a body, if it is very mild, it will not be severe, but sometimes it might lead to human life also will be the cost of it. So, earthing is very important. So, how it is done, if you see here, there will be a rod, copper rod or something that will be driven into the ground, and that will be connected by means of a wire that is called a conductor, earth conductor, to the mains. So, this rod will be put inside a pit so that it is safe, and also this area that is surrounding the rod, that will be depending on the soil condition will be modulated. So, the solid copper rod is driven into the soil, usually outside the building, and it will be connected to the main electric panel. This is what we do as earthing, this is what is basically earthing. But these earthing, instead of the rod, we can have many types depending on the type of material you use, I mean the configuration of the material, it is a plate earthing or pipe earthing, rod earthing or strip or wire earthing. So, plate earthing is nothing but you will have, instead of the rod, you will be seeing a plate, you can see here. Instead of the rod, there will be a plate. All the other things are the same. There is just this plate, but this plate you cannot use in everywhere. the dimension of the plate has to be 60 centimeter by 60 centimeter and the thickness should be 3.18. If it is going to be copper, if you are going to use galvanized iron, it will be a much thicker, like 6.35 mm thickness has to be there. So, this is buried vertically in the earth, like however you bury your rod in the pit. It should not be less than 3 meters from the ground when we use. So, these are the sizes and how you bury it and what is the depth you are going to bury it will make the difference in different types of earthing here. Then you have pipe earthing. Pipe earthing will be like the material earthing rod will be replaced by a galvanized iron pipe. So, again these pipe the other things are the same, it is connected here with the conductor. So, this is a this pipe will be a perforated pipe. So, the length and diameter will be like as per standards is 38 mm in dia and 2 meter length will be there. So, this is again placed vertically in a wet soil. So, this is the common system we generally follow in a earthing, if you are doing an earthing. Rod earthing is, this is similar to pipe earthing, but it is very cheap, you do not go into excavation, which means like it is very closer to the surface of the ground. So, if you take a copper rod, it will be 12.5 mm dia or 16 mm dia. For a galvanized steel, it will be 25 mm of GI pipe. So, it is length of 2.5 meter is enough. And the length of the embedded electrons in the soil reduces the earth resistance to a desired value. So, when you are doing this earthing, the whatever material we are burying in the soil, that is going to take up the electrical charge for whichever appliances that is not connected. So, that is distributed to the soil. So, the embedded electrodes will take up this and it will give away into the soil. Now, again the other method we have strip earthing. You have strip electrodes will be used in this method. The strip will be 25 mm by 1.6 mm and it is buried at the depth of 0.5 meter. So, if you see the cross sections and the depth of the where you bury the electrodes or the earthing material is making the difference, that is the installation system makes the difference. So, this is strip earthing is generally used in rocky soil where the excavation is difficult. So, if it is going to be a rocky soil, you can just drill holes and you can insert it, you cannot excavate the area. Now, when it comes to ISI specification, this earthing has to be following some ISI. Generally, ISI is a certification mark, it is given for industrial products all over in India. So, for earthing, we have to follow this IS 3043:1987 code of practice for earthing. So, when you do the earthing based on this code of practice, then it is said to be an ISI specified earthing. So, this is mandatory for products like electrical appliances. Now, as per this specification, this electrode should be placed at least 1.5 meter from the building, that is away from the building, outside the building it should be at least 1.5 meter. The earth wire and the electrode both should be of the same material, you cannot use different materials. The minimum sectional area has been said like it is 0.02 square inches and not more than 0.1 square inches. And the size of the earth conductor should not be less than half of the section of the line conductor. So, you have earth conductor and light conductor, that size has to be followed. Again the wire that is taken through the GI pipe should be 12 mm dia and at least 32 mm length of the pipe should be used below the ground surface. When you have loose earth, you mix coal and salt together as a mixture and that should be filled around the excavation pit or trench that you are doing for the earthing. So, the earth wire connected to the electrode should be run along the whole wiring system that has to run, it is not only to the for the earthing part. Now, coming to wiring, electrical wiring is the main only way that we can distribute the power to the entire building. So, this is also helps us to distribute it in a perfect manner and economically we can do it. In wiring, when you say the state electricity board, which whoever is providing current to our premises, it will come and stop outside our building. So, from the building we have to take inside our building and to various areas of the rooms and various floors, that is done using our wiring system. So, the customer has to take the connection from the point where the state electricity supply board has stopped to the main switchboard. From there it is taken to the main switchboard and then it is distributed all over the building. Now, when you take up this wiring system, you have many types again. You have cleat wiring, casing wiring, batten wiring, conduit wiring and concealed wiring. Various methods are being applied here. When you take cleat wiring, this is porcelain cleats are used. This also can be of wood or plastic. These will be fixed to the walls. The holes that you see here, the screws can be used and they can be fixed to the walls, and it is fixed at regular intervals. There is a gap of 0.6 meter should be there between each cleat that you are fixing. And the wires, PVC insulated cables, that is the wires will be run through the gaps that you see here through the holes, and thus you the cleat will support the wire. You see the cross section here. So, through these gaps the wires can be passed through. So, this is actually a very inexpensive method of wiring, but it is not suitable for home electrical wiring, and it is also a very outdated method, which is it's a very old method. Then you have a casing and capping wiring. Here what happens is you have a wooden casing which has grooves will be used. As the picture that you see here will show you that. This is grooves you see here inside, this is the wire that is coming outside. So, these grooves will be there, which will take up the wires throughout the wherever you require. So, this casing will be of a fixed length and parallel grooves will be there to accommodate the cables. This casing will be fixed to the walls and ceilings directly by the screws. After placing the cables inside, the groove will be, it will be like having a base and a cap. So, you will be closing it with a cap, so the cables will be covered. Then when you see this, this is a very cheap form of wiring comparatively. So, this is your casing. You might have seen these kinds of thing where in olden houses where you do not have a concealed wiring, but you have to take a new wiring, people go for this casing wiring. So, the disadvantage is this is this has a very high risk of fire because it is open. Now, batten wiring, this is like the insulated wires will be run through straight teak wooden battens. There will be wooden battens fixed on the wall or ceiling, and the wires will be run along with it and clipped by using plugs or clips. Brass link clips will be used. This will be these clips that we are using to fix these wires will be should be rust resistant. Nails will be used. So, if you see it closer, this also you can see in very old houses. So, this whole length you will be having wooden battens, a piece of wood that is put there, and the wires are run through this, these are the clips. So, this is a very simple and also a cheap method, and it is it will take very less time to install because it is you just put the batten, take the wires and fix it. This is particularly they use it for indoor installations, you cannot use it outdoor because the wires are not covered, it is exposed. Now, conduit wiring. PVC cables will be taken through PVC conduit pipes or through steel conduit pipes. This conduit wiring can be classified as surface and concealed. So, this is what a surface conduit wiring will look like. The conduits are seen outside, and this is a concealed where you do not see any, you just see the wires, you do not see the conduits. Conduits are nothing but the pipes through which we run the wires. So, when you take a surface conduit, the pipes are run on the surface of the walls and ceilings. Now, holes will be made on the surface of the wall to the distances, and then again this will be clipped like your batten wiring. And concealed wiring, what happens is they will cut through the wall and they will put the conduits inside, and the wires will be later on pulled through it. So, now this conduit concealed conduit wiring is most popular method for its aesthetic appearance, we use that. Now, when you take conduit wiring, again you have two different types of conduit, metal conduit and non-metallic conduit. The conduits, when you take metal, it is made of steel. When you use steel, it is very strong, but it is costly. But when you take non-metallic, we have solid PVC conduits. This is very flexible and easy to bend and easy to handle. When we see about wires, see the wires are going to go all around the house. So, we need to have a drawing, or we need to know where which wire is going, and if there is going to be a fault, we have to check these drawings, and then we have to find the fault where it is there and we have to repair it. So, for that we have a electrical wiring diagram. So, the main role is to convey information and the connection of various devices and equipments, how it is done. So, this information will provide the complete design or plan of the circuit or electrical installation. and how you have assembled various things. So when you take the different types of drawings, basically you have block diagram, circuit diagram and line diagram. When you take a block diagram, you see all the appliances and fixtures are represented as blocks. So you, the main fuse is here, from there you have three SPST switches, that is represented as another block, and from there it is connected to a lamp and a fan and a motor. So when it is represented in a blocks, this is a very symbolic representation of how you are connecting. It is a very initial level, you will have a block diagram. Then you have a circuit diagram. This circuit diagram, you see, you have a very clear line where how the wire is being taken up. Here you will have certain symbols for representing the things. So this is like this symbol represents it is a duplex receptacle, and this is a fluorescent lamp. There is a legend provided here. So you in the drawing will just use these symbols and we do the circuit. So now you know from where it goes through the wire, how it goes through. Then you have a line diagram. This line diagram will be a more detailed diagram where you see you have three different lines, and again you have a legend here. It is line 1, what it is represent, line 2 representation, line 3 representation. Now this is also shows the various, even the till the switches detail you can see, whether that switch is one way switch or two way switch, that is like whether that switch you have to operate it in one place. Two way switch means that two switches will be provided in two different places and one appliances can be operated from two places. So the detail will be to that extent that line diagram will be very, very detailed. So these are the three diagrams that we have for any wiring diagram. So what is a wiring diagram? As a definition, it is a pictorial representation of the circuit. So it shows the wiring between the parts, elements or equipments. It also gives detailed information, as I told you, about how you have made the connection between the devices. So it includes the relative position, arrangement of the devices and also terminals on the devices. Why we need a wiring diagram means somebody else is going to do the wiring and somebody else is going to be the user. So a diagram will be like a stable thing to have for future references. So in a wiring diagram, what and all we can have is the power supplies and earth connections, control and signal functions, termination of unused contacts and leads, interconnections via plugs, blocks, whatever you are using. All those things can be seen in a wiring diagram. Now we have something called electrical bus bars. Commercial and industrial distribution systems, if you take, they have huge conducting, huge voltage of current will be distributed. So what they do is cables and conduits will be very costly to distribute these things, because the cables are going to be very heavy, the number of cables will be more. So the conduits also will have to be a bigger size. So what happens is finally we end up with a very costly system, and it is also time consuming to install all the conduits because it is going to be a huge installation. So for this we use bus bars. So bus bars will take up the work of your cables and conduits and it will distribute the electricity in this building. So bus bar is a conductor that serves as a common connection for two or more circuits. So generally when you see a bus bar will be like a, as you saw in the previous picture, it is just a it is a copper conductor. So the high voltage will be generally passed through this, and from this it will, this is taken to distribution boards and from there it will be taken to individual places. So it is represented when you take when you say if you want to represent on a diagram, it is represented as a straight line. And there are number of connections, that is what this will run through the entire building in a core, and from there you will take the different separate connections, that is what we call as branch circuits. These bus bars may be aluminium or copper. Defined by National Electrical Manufacturer Association, NEMA, it is a prefabricated electrical distribution system. So it comes as a whole setup. We are not going to set up anything in this. Comes as a whole setup. So this is your bus bar and it has various connections for distribution. So this is the housing which is going to be putting everything inside, and there is a epoxy insulation also. So it is a prefabricated system, and it also protective enclosure. It also has a support material and housing, that is what we saw already. So how this distribution system works with the busway is, it is very easy to connect the various sections. It can be supplied to any area of a building. As I told you, generally when we plan it, it will be taken in the core of the building, alongside the core, and from there it will be distributed. So when you use a bus bar instead of cables and conduits, you can save up to 35% of man hours for installation, or if you want to change a busway system. So in a many systems you can use can be connected to the busway. It can either be a cable system or a conduit system. Now when you take the types of busways, you have horizontal and vertical. Horizontal is used for industrial locations. So it is used to power heavy equipment, too many of lights and air conditioning will be used horizontally. Vertically, this is what I said, busway risers. So in high rise buildings, it is going to be very tedious to take up the wires for so much of a height. So bus bars will be very useful if you place it in the cores and take it up. So it also is used to distribute lighting and air conditioning loads. Now based on the level of the electrical distribution, categorize it. From the transformer, you have something called MLVS busways. From the sub distribution to low or high tap off densities, and lighting distribution busways. Transformer to MLVS busways is, this is a very permanent thing. See, like from the state electricity board, it has come to a premises. From the premises, it will be taken to the transformer. So from the transformer, when you take into the building, it is taken as MLVS busways. So here there will be no tap off points. Tap off points are points where from where you can connect any appliances. So there will be no tap off points when it comes to MLVS busways. So it is used for very short runs, very small shorter distances, where a parallel cable will be very impossible to do that. Generally it is 1600 to 200 amps we use this. It is also to connect between MLVS and downstream switchboards. Again, from MSV you have to go to switchboards, you can use this type of busways. Now from sub distribution, how we are going to take the for tap off density. So you for mid size premises and small sites, we use this type of a busway. So industrial workshops with many machines and large supermarkets, you will have heavy loads there, you will use this type of a busway. And if it is going to be very small sites, where you have like workshops with many machine tools, textile factories, there will be too many machines and you will need too many tap off points. So tap off points, again I told you, like power points or socket points like that. So with for that we will use this downstream. And also there will be many modifications and upgrades when you are having too many tap off points. So maybe you are going to change, if it is going to be a textile factory, they are going to change the particular they are upgrading the equipment or machinery. So when they upgrade the machinery, obviously the tap off point also sometimes might you have to change. So this main modification upgrade is easy when you are using the busways, and dependability and continuity of service can also be done with this type of busways. Now when you come to lighting distribution, this busways is purely when you are using lighting circuits, and there are two types, again designed for the suspension, and suspension is not there, but it is designed for lighting fixtures. So for designed for means you supply and support the lighting fixtures, like industrial reflectors or discharge lamps, or if you see like in studios where be like a array of lights you have will be suspended. So there you use light distribution busways, and this will be very rigid because the system is fixed, and the tap off outlets will be from for every 0.5 meter to 1 meter. And if it is not designed also, you will have a prefabricated cable system so that you can supply all lighting fixtures, and this will be like more or less where you can have wherever you want you can use the lighting fixtures. Generally you see this kind of a thing in a false ceiling. If you take an office or something, if there is a false ceiling where you require, you just fix the lighting. The thing is very flexible. So the tap off outlets for this will be for from 0.2 to 0.3 3 meters. So from this lecture we understood the basics of electricity, electrical circuits, and we also had a brief about the laws of electrical circuits. And then we understood what is earthing, what are the different types of earthing systems we had, what is the need for them, and even the ISA specification for an earthing system. And then we came across your electrical wiring system methods, different types of wirings we saw, different methods of wiring, and various capacity of wires also we came across. So the possible questions will be like the laws of electrical. What are the laws of electrical circuits? Or explain the earthing system and its need. This is a very important thing when it comes to electricity. Write in detail about the electric wiring system and its type. So all the different types of wiring system you will have to list down, and different wiring diagrams. We saw wiring diagrams and where what is used. So these will be the probable questions for this lecture. So with this, we come to the end of this lecture. Thank you.